second half of managerial economics meeting after a very long time. Okay, we'll start with your chapter 9 to chapter 12. This entire chapters are interlinked with each other and they are related with markets. Now students, whenever you talk about markets, what comes into your mind? The word market, when you hear it, what comes into your mind? What picture comes into your mind? Okay, you talk about 4 P's, place of transaction, fine, business, buying and selling, transaction of money and goods. Okay, fine, buyers and sellers, selling place. I want you to also think on, when we use the word market, can we, it's a very general term. The word market can be related to so many things, like you have what is called product market. Product market is what you see across in number of consumer goods, fruits, vegetables, perishable, durable goods. That's product market, where buying and selling of products take place. Then we have what is called as the real estate market, where again you have the buying and selling of property. Share market. Yeah, good evening, Suprakash. Yeah, then you have what is called as the factor market, the labor market. We are talking about jobs, employment. Yeah, good evening, Mandi. Samir will be sending you the link and the PPTs. Okay, so you have different types of market. The word market here is a very general term. Now, when you talk about market in economics, markets are purely divided into two categories, the perfect competition and the imperfect. Rishikesh, you need to download it. Download this link which has been sent to you. Okay? Only then you will be able to... Only then will you be able to download it. Okay. We'll go ahead. Done. Great. Okay. So when we talk about perfect competition, as you see slide number, this is the first slide, right? The first slide is, market is a network of dealing between buyers and sellers. Now please concentrate on the very first line. We are done away with the geographical limitation of market. We don't say that market is a place where buyers and sellers meet. Why are we not still carrying on with our traditional definition that market is a place where buyers and sellers meet? Why we are going ahead in today's modern times, we are saying that any transaction, any type of networking between the buyers and sellers is more than enough to generalize the term market. Of course, that's right, Rishikesh and Samir. It's because of online. I was reading the Economic Times paper of 7th May, that is yesterday, and I'm always telling my students that they need to regularly keep reading the ET newspaper. It's about Kishore Biyani, who is talking about Big Bazaar, which will be going live next month with an app. They are also introducing an app with which you can go for online buying. Now, he said that this is because of the rapid adoption of e-commerce in India. They are doing that to beat the online retailers for the price cutting strategy. Now, in order to enter the online, online buying and selling, they said that they are planning to give a price match offer. They said that customers will have enough of time to compare the prices of certain products. And if they get the price lower than what the Big Bazaar is offering them, then they will get credit. They will automatically get credit points. See, when you talk about Flipkart, you talk about Amazon, you talk about Snapdeal, they are all the competitors who are competing in this online market. I mean, students, that whenever you pick up the newspapers, you look at the article and try to relate it with what you are studying here. I'm just saying that the very first line, market is a network of dealings. I have taken this as an example of online businesses which are going on, and how the existing organized retailers are also forced to enter into this e-commerce online buying and selling. And there's a prediction which is given that by 2013, the online market will have crossed more than $200 billion business, which is pretty a big amount of business. Correct? So market is what? Today we are talking about market at a very, very broad scenario where there is, it's not that the number of buyers and the number of sellers have increased enormously. It's not located to one local area, but yes, we cannot ignore the fact that everybody is not into online buying. There are still places where people prefer to go down to a nearby grocery store to pick up a few products. So market, traditional definition of market still applies. What are you learning in this chapter is to identify the behavior of sellers and buyers. So formally, theoretically, the theory says that we need to classify market on the basis of competition. And on the basis of competition, market is getting classified, taking you to slide number second, perfect and the imperfect market. So the very, very important thing to be remembered is that markets are classified into two broad categories on the basis of competition. So which are those two broad categories? Come on, quickly give me the answers. I will be taking your test like this. I'll be questioning you to what I'm explaining. You can see the slide and answer me. This would also help you to prepare. Yeah, good evening, Mahesh. We are on chapter number 9, just started. Slide number 2. The link has been sent to you. Very good. So Sandeep, Pronita, Sanjeevni, all are giving the example that market is divided into perfect and imperfect. Yeah, good evening, Vinod, Shashank. We are on chapter number 9. Slide number 2, just started with what market is. So markets are broadly classified into the perfect and the imperfect types. Yeah, good evening, Vasanti. So what are the imperfect types of market? Look at the slide, students. You're actually learning. In this session, you're actually learning. Okay. So imperfect markets, how many can you see in the screen? The last paragraph. How many types of imperfect markets are given? One, two, three, four. Four. Monopoly, duopoly, oligopoly, and monopolistic competition. These four are coming under the imperfect market forms. Why are they called imperfect? You will see in the next slide very clearly. Yeah, good evening, Reddy. Slide number 3. If you see, this is a summarized flow chart consisting of the four main market forms. Duopoly is not included in your chapter, so we have not prepared a column for duopoly. So what you find is only three types of imperfect market forms are given in this chart. Duopoly is a market of two sellers, where you have absolutely two companies controlling the maximum market share. You will find this always in most of these market forms, like when you talk about two new carriers, two new domestic carriers which came up, the Vistara and Air Asia India. They will be considered as two newcomers, but they are not called as duopoly, sorry, because duopoly is a market where you have two main players who are one of the most closest competitors having a largest market share. So when you talk about Microsoft Office, which is the closest competitor today of Microsoft Office? It is definitely capturing more than 80% of the market share. But which okay, so when you talk about Apple or when you talk about Open Office 365, these becomes like duopoly. You have a large percent of the market share captured by two strongest competitor. Fine. Yeah, Rishikesh is giving us an example of DU and Etisalat telecommunication companies in Dubai, where you have two strongest competitor. Perfect. So go back to slide number three. Slide number three. So I want to make you one thing very clear, that duopoly is called as a special type of oligopoly. Note it down. Please note it down. Duopoly is a special type of oligopoly. Yes. And excuse me. Yeah. And when you talk about, write it down. Duopoly is a special type of oligopoly. Okay. Now look at the slide number three, students. Perfect competition, in one look you get an idea that perfect competition and monopolistic competition has the largest number of companies, more than 100, more than 50. Now what is the major difference between monopoly and monopolistic competition? Monopoly is one seller, whereas monopolistic competition is large sellers. So never get confused between monopolistic competition and monopoly. So when you see that monopolistic competition, there are large number of sellers who are selling close substitutes. Examples are given down, Rishikesh, if you see the slide carefully. I give you 2 minutes. I want you to quickly go through this market structure, read it properly, and then I'll ask you some questions. Fine? Yeah, good evening, Ravina. Okay, let me tell you, if you look at this slide, you will find that a market where there are large number of sellers selling homogeneous product with very little entry barriers. Most of the companies are selling exactly identical products. Then they do not have any power over price. They become price takers and they continue enjoying normal profit, which is nothing but considered as a case of what is called perfect competition. I'll read out something. Here they are saying that perfect competition is a market where you have large number of companies who are selling identical products. PC stands for perfect competition. Each firm will have no control, each firm will not be having any type of influence over price. It's a theoretical concept. It's like a benchmark to study what the real competition is. It's just a model. So where do you find this market? Large number of sellers selling same product with absolutely no control over price. They have to take the market price as given. Vegetable vendors, petrol, all the petrol pumps are selling the fuel. So what is the most important thing to remember, student, is that in perfect competition, there is no branding. Even if there's a branding, it's same. Similar automobile spare parts or some standardized product, like for example, raw iron, mining. Mining companies will come under perfect competition. Sand will come under perfect competition because the quality does not differ. So all the companies who are into mining are extracting the same type of iron or whatever is the mineral resource in the raw form. Sand, companies dealing with the sand is again coming under perfect competition, where you cannot differentiate coal, yes. So iron ore, coal, sand, mineral resources, all the mining companies dealing into that will enter into a perfect competition model. They will see what the market price is and accordingly. No, medicines will not. Rishikesh, medicines have patents. They have differentiation. But in perfect competition, it does not matter. You can go and buy it from anyone. Like for example, when I'm talking about a very simple example. If you, yes, vegetables. No, again, furniture have design. There are a lot of designs which cannot be copied. Exclusive. But yes, yes, now that when you talk about Ranjan furniture, what immediately comes into my mind is benches. If all the benches are all exactly similar, then there is no differentiation. No Kalpana. Cosmetics again have branding. You have Lakme product, you have Elle product, you have so many brands. तो परफेक्ट कंपटीशन का मतलब है जहां पर आप डिफरेंशिएशन नहीं कर सकते हो, इलेक्ट्रिसिटी, फूड ग्रेन्स, करेक्ट? सो द प्रोडक्ट इज लाइक व्हेन यू गो टू फैशन स्ट्रीट इन मुंबई और इफ यू गो टू लिंकिंग रोड इन मुंबई, यू विल फाइंड हंड्रेड्स ऑफ वेंडर्स एंड मेनी वेंडर्स हु आर सेलिंग ऑलमोस्ट सिमिलर टाइप ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स. सो व्हाट द कस्टमर, कस्टमर इज लाइक अ किंग एंड एवरीबॉडी इज ट्राइंग टू कन्विंस एंड इन्फ्लुएंस द कस्टमर. So what happens is, in perfect competition model, it was a model which was existing years back, but even today you find it. Farmer, Samadhan and many students are giving examples of farmers. Now farmers, when they are selling the wheat to the mandi, the price at which the government has decided to purchase wheat or any other crop, it is almost like perfect competition. They are price takers. They are selling the food grains at a given price, and almost the quality. Of course, there are different types of wheat, but in a particular state, like the state of Madhya Pradesh or the state of Punjab or the state of Gujarat, you'll find the entire quantity of wheat is purchased in bulk without any differentiation. It is like one grain of wheat. If you compare it with another grain of wheat from the same field, it will be almost alike. So homogeneous is exactly similar. Correct? Now, when I'm talking about, let's say if you miss one particular local train, you will not return home because you know the next local train which will come will take me again to my same. So that's exactly homogeneous service. Well, perfect competition is a model where you will have absolutely tough competition because all are selling same products, and it becomes very difficult. But yes, there is no commitment or loyalty. If you find that a particular shop is closed, you will, or a particular vendor selling vegetables is not there, you'll switch over to somebody else. So homogeneity, I can tell you, is a very simple example when in Diwali you will find the Mumbai streets flooded with those mud diyas, or you will find this type of perfect competition when you go to church gate or that underground shops. They are almost selling the same. I found this in just a few days back. I had been there and I found that most of these shops were selling some type of these China watches, and most of these China watches had absolutely the same design, absolutely the same. There was no difference. So I thought that's perfect competition. There are many sellers and they are selling identical type of watches. So it does not matter from whomsoever a person can go and buy. Similarly, yeah. Steel, glass, yes. No, they are not perfect competition, Girish. Though the product is standardized, but if you have only then it will be like a few sellers, oligopoly. So it's very important that we should not look only for the product. We should look at the very first feature, how many companies are there. So when you talk about steel, gas, which are owned by government, it will come under monopoly. Yeah, Devashri, we have already sent you the PPTs. I'm sending you the link. It can be seasonal part-time seller. Okay, look ahead. Now, monopolistic competition came up because perfect competition made there was no chance of making higher profits. So companies thought, why not we start differentiating our products? You will find most of the features are same except product type. The moment the product starts getting differentiated, we say it is a case of monopolistic competition. So in monopolistic competition, you will find that there are again large number of companies, but they are all selling close substitutes. So all the fast moving consumer goods, FMCG, comes under monopolistic competition. So when you talk about electronics, when you talk about real estate, when you talk about let's say rubber making, tire making companies. If there are many, then it's monopolistic competition. Film industry comes under monopolistic competition. N number of production houses. But there is a differentiation. The most important thing is each company will have a particular feature which will be different from the rival product. So it is monopoly. Monopoly because of brand. Monopoly because of some distinct characteristic. But still competition because you are selling a close substitute. So when you talk about Samsung, Sensui, LG, Nokia, and many other, there's a competition. You're getting it. Products are differentiated in designing, in pricing, in features, in color. गिरीश, आई एम टेलिंग यू, ये मोनोपोलिस्टिक कंपटीशन है. आपके पास मोनोपोली वो लास्ट कैटेगरी में. मोनोपोली इज वेर यू हैव अ सिंगल सेलर सेलिंग अ प्रोडक्ट विच हैव नो सब्स्टिट्यूट्स. नाउ व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स, इट विल नॉट कम अंडर मोनोपोली. इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स देर आर सो मेनी कंपनीज. बट व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट या नितिन, ओके, when you talk about Indian Railways, or when you talk about let's say when you talk about SAIL, or when you talk about SEBI, these are coming under monopoly. Yeah, BEST buses in Mumbai will be monopoly. Sanjeevni, you are right. Yeah, Shiv Kumar, I've sent you the link. Defense will be a monopoly. So monopoly is what? In fact, you will have monopoly. Yeah, McDonald's, KFC will come under monopolistic competition because you have so many fast food outlets. So consumers have a lot of variety, taste, preference, and accordingly they will decide. Oligopoly is a market which is of few sellers, less than 10, not more than 20 companies. So when you have few sellers, telecom will come under oligopoly. 5-star and 7-star hotels will come under oligopoly. Travel and tourism will come under oligopoly. Airlines will of course come under oligopoly, few sellers, and they are dominating the market. They may be into standardized services, like when you talk about mining, it's standardized, but there are few mining firms, so that will come under oligopoly. See, it all depends. We need to collect the data. Yes, how much licenses should be given? Totally depends on the monopoly of the government. It depends on the government's rules and regulations. Government itself is a system. It will decide. That is why businesses totally depend on who the ruling government is. Because the government which comes into power will have the entire power to decide whether they need to give licenses or not. Yes, Samir, you are right. So oligopoly is a market of few sellers. So I think this is very clear for you students, but one thing which I want to make it very, very clear. These markets, this is a theory, it's a model, but you will have n number of different markets, huh? You will have to remember that these markets are overlapping each other. Okay? You have to see that these markets are overlapping each other. Yeah, I've already sent you the link, Sumit. Okay, so if you go in your area, like if you go in your area and if there's only one vegetable vendor in your area and majority of the people are buying from him, then he will enjoy a monopoly there. Yeah, we are on chapter number 9, slide number 3. No, there are no new theories. These are the only theories. Multinational companies are coming under oligopoly market. There are few multinational companies and they have their own nature of business. Clear? So there's a overlapping of these markets. Like I gave you, jewelers will come under again monopolistic competition because each jeweler has an exclusive design that he carries. But there are n number of jewelers. So they are all competing with each other. Okay, we go ahead. Now we will go systematically into understanding some of the features that will make your concepts even more clear. Slide number 4, chapter number 9 gives you 6 conditions to be satisfied for perfect competition. Mahesh had already said that duopoly consists of two sellers who have the largest market share. If you take the example of Airbus and Boeing are the two major players in the aircraft manufacturing. So they are enjoying a very large percent of the market, which makes them duopoly, two sellers, Coke and Pepsi, again duopoly, two sellers competing. Yes. So when you look here, you'll find six conditions are given. Now, the six conditions will never satisfied in real life. These are six conditions for perfect competition, but what you see in your market, slide number five, is pure competition. So pure competition or perfect competition mein kya difference hai? What's the difference between pure competition and perfect competition? In pure competition, you require three conditions. In perfect competition, you require six conditions. So important question for the exam. Difference between pure competition and perfect competition. Yes? Now, in this market, since each seller is not having any power over price, each seller is considered as only a price taker. To prove that point that each seller is a price taker, transport mobility was taken into consideration, taking you back to this slide number five, when we had those colonized economies under the British rule. Every village was a self-sufficient village, where whatever was to be manufactured, produced, sold, it was within the village. So there was no transport as such, moving the products from one place to the other. Shweta, look at slide number five carefully. Pure competition, how many points are written below that? Three. Large number of buyers and sellers, homogeneity, free entry and exit. So vegetable market totally comes under this pure competition. You have large number of sellers, large number of buyers. Most of the vegetables, fruits are almost identical. Free entry and exit. But when you add perfect knowledge does means that hotels will not come under perfect pure competition because they are selling altogether a different menu. Even if you go to two different South Indian restaurants, I think there is going to be a difference in taste. But here there has to be absolutely no difference. Maybe a mobile charger, a Chinese mobile charger that is being sold on the streets, or that racket, mosquito racket. It's perfect homogeneity. The product has absolutely no differentiation except the color. So that's homogeneous. Coconuts. Tuitions and classes will not come under perfect but monopolistic competition. Perfect market knowledge means where the buyer and the seller both have the knowledge about the market price. तो कोई किसी को बेवकूफ नहीं बना सकता है. तो आई थिंक ये तो आजकल वो ऑनलाइन में भी है ना, ऑनलाइन ऑनलाइन में जो प्रोडक्ट्स और उनके प्राइजेस दिए जाते हैं, दैट इज लीडिंग टू दिस कंडीशन कॉल्ड परफेक्ट नॉलेज अबाउट मार्केट प्राइजेस. एंड परफेक्ट मोबिलिटी, व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट परफेक्ट मोबिलिटी, यहाँ पर हम किसकी बात कर रहे हैं? हम बात कर रहे हैं मोबिलिटी ऑफ रिसोर्सेस. आई वॉन्ट टू मेक इट क्लियर दैट मेनी अ टाइम्स इट वॉज फाउंड दैट परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन मोर फिट्स इन टू what example are you talking about, Shashank? Yeah, good evening, Aarti. We are on chapter 9, just not, you have not missed much. Just very slowly we are going ahead with the chapter. So when we are talking about perfect mobility, means mobility of resources, you will find that perfect competition model more fits into the unorganized sector, where people are investing a very small amount of their capital. And if they find that they are not able to make profit in the business, they will quit. A simple example is fishermen. Fishermen are going every day to the ocean to catch fishes. If they find that the fishing activity is not giving them enough of revenue, they will quit. And they will, I'm just giving an example, it's an assumption. So mobility of resources. Second example of mobility of resources is labor. पर डे वेजेस पर जो आप लेबर लेते हैं, सपोज यू आर अ कॉन्ट्रैक्टर, आप पर डे वेजेस पर लेबर को हायर करते, वो परफेक्टली मोबाइल है. अगर उनको 2 पैसे ज्यादा कहीं और मिलेंगे, दे विल लीव एंड दे विल गो. सो इट्स अ अनऑर्गेनाइज सेक्टर वेर यू विल फाइंड दिस परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन मॉडल अ लिटिल बिट एप्लीकेबल सम कंडीशंस. करेक्ट. इवन द होम डोमेस्टिक सर्वेंट्स विल सैटिस्फाई सम कंडीशंस लाइक लार्ज नंबर ऑफ सेलर्स, लार्ज नंबर ऑफ डोमेस्टिक हेल्प रेडी टू ऑफर देयर सर्विसेस. करेक्ट. फ्री एंट्री एंड एग्जिट, विच मीन्स दे नीड नॉट हैव एनी लाइसेंसिंग फॉर दैट. दे हैव परफेक्ट नॉलेज अबाउट द वर्क एंड अबाउट द रेट्स विच आर गिवन इन दैट एरिया. दे आर परफेक्टली मोबाइल. इफ दे फाइंड दैट दे आर पेड 100 रुपीज समवेयर एल्स मोर, दे विल स्टॉप कमिंग टू योर हाउस एंड वर्किंग. Now, no transport cost was only a condition where the seller is manufacturing the product at his own place and selling it in the nearby. Where the resources are available, no transport cost is very, very difficult to apply in today's market. It's like a gardener and he has cultivated a beautiful flowers in his garden and he's selling just outside his garden a bouquet. A bouquet shop very next to the garden, then there will be no transport cost. But still, he will have to spend money na, to buy the inputs. Pure competition is where there are 3 conditions satisfying: large number of buyers and sellers, homogeneous commodity, free entry and exit. Perfect competition banne ke liye 3 aur conditions add honge. Look at slide number 4. Please, please, students, compare slide number 4 and slide number 5. To understand the difference between pure and perfect competition. Perfect competition will have more conditions, so it's a wider concept. Okay, I move ahead to slide number 6, where you see a diagram given to you. Shashank, Larsen and Toubro, you are talking about L&T. It will come under monopolistic competition. There are many n number of companies depending on the product. Now, what product is the company making? Steel, standardized product that it is making. It also depends on the nature of activity. Today, companies are becoming multi-product companies. So it will be monopolistic competition. Monopoly is the only seller. If you take, let's talk about cement. Is L&T the only manufacturer of cement? Then it will not come under monopoly. It will be monopolistic competition kyunki bahut sari aur companies bhi cement bana rahe. To monopolistic competition ka matlab hota hai jahan par ek company nahi, bahut sare companies uska substitute bana rahe because of branding. बहुत सारे कंपनीज टायर बना रहे, बहुत सारे कंपनीज ऑटोमोबाइल्स बना रहे, तो वो सब किसमें आ जाएगा? मोनोपोलिस्टिक कंपटीशन. लेकिन मोनोपोली क्यों बोला है? बिकॉज ऑफ देयर ब्रांड. जिसको L&T का सीमेंट लेना है वो वही लेगा, जिसको अंबुजा सीमेंट लेना है वो वही प्रेफर करेगा, जिसको एशियन पेंट्स लेना है वो लोग एशियन पेंट. सो देयर इज लिटिल बिट ऑफ कस्टमर लॉयल्टी. ओके, नाउ इन दिस मार्केट यू विल फाइंड दैट द डिमांड एंड सप्लाई ग्राफ आर शोन. This graph is only shown to make you understand that in the market, there are 2 opposite forces which are ruling the market. And which are those? Demand and supply. So demand and supply are said to be the 2 most important market forces. And the price which is decided by these forces will be called as equilibrium price. So what is equilibrium price? It is the price at which the market clears. The demand becomes exactly equal to the supply. But we know that this diagram is just a theoretical concept. Our markets are very temporarily into equilibrium. What you see every day is that there's a lot of fluctuation in the market, depending on how many buyers come, how many sellers exit, how many buyers exit. So what happens is, in the market, you will find many a times there are fluctuations. Now, I was reading these Economic Times newspapers and I didn't get much of time to note down things. So I carried the newspapers with me. Okay. Now, If I'm taking three different Economic Times newspaper, will it come under homogeneous or differentiation product? Tell me. It's all having the same color and it's all having a heading called Economic Times. I have, let's say, will it be homogeneous or differentiation? And whatever you say, you have to give me a reason for that. Why did you say it is homogeneous and why you said it is differentiation? Okay, homogeneous because the title is same. Okay, agreed. Why do you say it is differentiation? Tell me. Correct. Sanjeevni is saying the news is different. Sandeep is saying they look similar and you feel similar carrying a Economic Times. The moment you have this paper in hand, you know. Okay, very good. So you have understood the concept of what is homogeneity and what is differentiation. To kya hua hai? Abhi overlapping ho gaya hai, dekho. Though the heading is the same and you say they almost look similar, that makes them homogeneous. But it's only when you go in depth, you understand that it always carries a different information, making it differentiation. So students, in the market, paper will be homogeneous. If you talk about the quality of the paper will be homogeneous, but the news in the paper is differentiation. So there's again an overlapping of two different conditions. Iska matlab, practically, jab aap real market mein jaoge, it is always a overlapping. So what is your job? Your job is to minutely understand and try to relate it with your theory and say, yes, this is the condition which is getting applied. This is the condition which makes it look like monopoly. This is a condition which makes me look like perfect competition. Okay. Sanjeevni is putting a very strong support statement saying that people are buying the newspaper only because they know that the news is going to be different. So that is one of the strongest reasons why the newspaper is being sold. If had it been homogeneous. Now I will add to that. Sanjeevni, is it necessary that you buy this newspaper from the same vendor? Suppose the vendor near your area says, sorry madam, aaj Economic Times yaha nahi hai. Will you not read the paper that day? What will you do, students, in that case? Buy it from someone else. So now what has happened here? Which conditions have got applied here? Which conditions of the chapter that you are studying is getting applied? Yes, Shweta, very good. Kiran, very good. Large number of buyers and sellers, perfect competition. Ranjan is talking about monopoly market. Students, you are trying to learn too many things at a time and therefore you are getting confused. You have to remember that this is microeconomics. You are isolating many things and learning one thing at a time. So your way of studying should be concentrating to one thing at a time. It's only macro you relate everything and try to understand. It is what I said. If Sanjeevni or anybody does not find the newspaper of Economic Times with a near vendor, will they stop reading the newspaper that day or they will find it? So there are large number of sellers selling the economics. So vendor selling newspaper will come under which condition? Vendors, large number of vendors. So it will come under the first condition, large number of buyers and sellers. Homogeneous product. Two conditions. So it is pure competition. Shashank, you need to go back to the chart again. I think I cannot go back again and again. Students, please try to understand that if I keep going back to the same slide and only concentrating, I will not be able to finish the topics which I need to. And unfortunately, we cannot devote too much of time. See, this is, I understand this is a VCF lecture, but there are some things which you need to little bit keep pace with. And time is one very important factor. So I request the students that they can use their study material and go to that. I had given you 5 to 6 minutes, students, to go back to the chart. How many, now Shashank wants to go back to that same chart, which was the flow chart. So do you want me to go back to that chart or go ahead? I'll go with majority. Okay, I'm sorry, Shashank, majority are voting for going ahead. So that's something which you need to go back on your own and read. But we are going to use that concept again and again in our chapter. So if you look at that slide number 7, you will see that there's a shift in the demand. When the demand shifts to the right, what is happening to the price? When the demand is shifting to the right, what's happening to the price? Price is increasing. So what does this graph reflect? It reflects that when the supply is constant and demand shifts, there are more people, there are more buyers, but we do not have enough of stock. Prices are going to increase, which you call as inflation. Do you think this is going to happen in case of agricultural products because of a bad monsoon? Most of the crops have got, so this diagram will reflect constant supply, but demand is, since food grains, fruits, vegetables are perishable, there's a recurring demand. So you'll never say that demand will stop. So supply has been same. I mean, there's a reduced supply. Okay, so there's an increase. So I think this diagram will not be reflecting, because you're, as Hrishikesh has just put in, that supply has reduced. The diagram is saying supply is same, but suddenly you find more people want to buy the product. So the prices will grow, increase. If there are large number of students who want to go for a VCF program, the fees can be hiked. Okay, anyway, or a higher price. Okay, if the students, something coming to my mind, very interesting. If the students are demanding more and more of sessions of a particular subject, more and more hours, but the supply is fixed in the sense the supply of my services will be fixed. So if there's a more demand, I'll say, okay, pay me higher. No, the college has to pay me more for the every extra hour that I'm going to put in. Well, we go ahead. What is happening here? I think this is the diagram which Hrishikesh has said. Supply has reduced because of the bad monsoon. Demand is constant. People are, the number of people who prefer to buy wheat, the people who prefer to buy vegetables or a particular type of pulses, they are same. But because there has been a monsoon failure, supply has reduced, so prices will go up. Good. So which are the two conditions where prices have gone up? Which are the two conditions where prices have gone up? When demand increases or when? Or when, which was the other? Supply decreases. Very good. Look here now, slide number nine. The supply has increased. I think this is what we talk about e-commerce. So many online companies coming up with n number of products that there is now more a price war. Who will be offering a lower price? So when there is too many sellers entering a particular market, you will find customers will get the benefit of buying the products or getting the products at a lower price, which is good. If you look at the electronic markets, if you look at the way the products are increasing, I think we have large number of companies in the few years which have come into the electronics, ready-made garments, furniture, that customers are able to get the benefit. We come to the last part of this chapter finally, that supply takes time to adjust to demand. Kyunki supply mein pehle production aata hai. Iske liye, yeah, Shweta, the four diagrams are just trying to tell you that in perfect competition, everything depends on market, and market mein prices kaise badalte hain depending on kaun stronger hai. The sellers are more or the buyers are more. Basically, depending on koi bhi cheez, agar uska demand zyada hai aur supply utna nahi hai, so automatically the prices will go up. Okay? Yeah. Then we go ahead to the last part of this chapter, where you can see that I've drawn again a flow chart where this concept is called as time element, where how much time supply takes to adjust to demand is explained. Hello, can you hear me? where you will find that the time is divided into four: very short, short, long, very long. This concept is introduced by Alfred Marshall. Very important question for the exam. Marshall has classified the time element into how many categories? Marshall has classified the time element four. Which are those four? Very short, short, long, very long. You will find that in the very short period, the supply is perfectly inelastic. Perfectly inelastic का मतलब होता है, supply cannot adjust to the demand. Today, even if there's more demand for a particular crop, farmers cannot suddenly grow those crops and supply it in the market. Because there is no stock, there is limited stock. Yes, emergency situations bring perfectly inelastic supply situation, Ranjan, very good. And that will lead to higher price. If you want, you pay a higher price. Okay, then the next is short period. Short period mein thoda flexibility hai, like one day, one week, you have time to go and adjust. So supply will become relatively inelastic. Prices will be higher than the original price. For example, when you talk about exhibitions which are there for 1 week, or you have this fairs, one day, you know, Bandra fair and all, you'll find lot of products are sold at a little higher price than the original, because it's a 1 week fair. There are lakhs of people coming, and definitely they don't mind spending a little higher for exclusive products which are there. Long period is unlimited time. Most of the products in the long run tend to become to the normal price. That's because there are large number of sellers who enter into the market. See, when you have a new handset or a new mobile coming in the market, initially it is at a very high price, but over a long run time you will find that its prices will start coming down, just because there are better products entering. So supply totally depends on time, how many sellers are there. And very long time period is totally criticized by a economist called J.M. Keynes. He says you cannot think about what will happen in the next 20 years. Today, if you look at the newspapers, I think our newspapers are all talking about very long time, like 2030. You are in 2013 and they are already predicting for 2030, based on some forecasting method, that this would be the billion market sales in 2030. But J.M. Keynes said that we should not predict about the supply or the market situation for a very long period of time. So when you look into the newspapers, I want you to search what is very short, short, long, and very long market, where you read in the news about the supply of a certain product which is going to increase in the next, 2015. I'm sorry, I was just talking about 2013. I don't know how did it come. I think I'm still back. Okay, so that's it. We finished with chapter number 9, and I would like to give you some multiple choice questions. Yeah, elasticity in the long and very long remains almost the same. Original price is what is prevailing, and high price is what you pay higher than the existing price. Like a bottle of blood in the blood bank will cost you higher at an emergency situation, or anything which you go for a very emergency situation, you need to pay a little higher price, especially services. You'll find this happening during any type of panic, like we had this Nepal and all these type of you can say natural calamities, where news was saying that people were paying much more price for a bottled water than what the original price was. So good. Yeah, immediate flight booking is also coming in very short and higher price. Very good, Ranjan. Welcome back, students. Good evening. MCQ we will be taking in the end so that you get an idea of what has been taught to you. And now we will be moving to chapter number 10. It was just a short break. And Ravi, I'm sending you the link. You have just missed one chapter. So don't worry, there will be a revision of that chapter when we move to chapter 12 again. So it's not difficult. Okay, don't worry. So we move to chapter number 10, where you see that this chapter is going to, it's a very theoretical chapter. I will be asking you questions, not now, but in the end. I just thought that why not I finish the teaching first and then in the end we will have only the MCQ chapter. I have to cover four chapters. Yes, definitely they'll be available in the link. I prepared separate MCQ questions. So let's quickly go ahead. In this chapter, students, you have to only remember the most important thing that after understanding what market structure is, we all have to remember that the type of market structure, whether it is perfect competition, it is monopoly or any other, it has a very important impact on the company's revenue. Because how much the company will be able to sell will depend on whether it is having a large market share or a smaller market share. Do you agree? If there are 10 vendors selling a same type of vegetables, then which vendor will make maximum revenue is very difficult to decide unless and until we come to know how much quantity he has sold at a given price. So this chapter is purely introducing you to the formulas and the meaning of revenue. There are three revenues that you need to remember, or revenue is divided into three types: total, average and marginal. So what is revenue? First of all, you need to be very clear in your mind. For which slide number one, first paragraph is clearly giving you the meaning of revenue. The word revenue stands for sales proceeds, income received or sale proceeds. Now, what does it mean? It means that revenue is an after sale concept. I cannot know what is total sales amount. How much the company will earn cannot be calculated unless I know the price and the quantity that the company is selling of a given product. So quickly remember and by heart these formulas. Total revenue is equal to price multiplied by quantity, as you see in the given slide. Average revenue, the formula is total revenue divided by quantity. Now, this is something interesting. It has been found that average revenue is nothing but price. Average revenue is nothing but the price of the product. If a company is selling 1,000 products, or let's put it like this, 100 products sold at the price of 100 products sold at the price of 10 each. 100 products sold at the price of 10 each. So what is the total revenue? 1,000. Suppose we try to use this formula here. If you divide this 1,000, that is 1,000 will be total revenue, upon Q, quantity was how much? 100. What answer will you get? So is it not the same as price? So average revenue and price are nothing but one and the same thing. So important question for the exam. The next is slide number 3, marginal revenue. When you talk about marginal, the word marginal has got very high importance in the subject of economics, especially for decision making. Should I take one extra lecture? Should I teach little more? Should I listen more? Should I attend more work? Should I sit 1 hour extra in the office? These are always our decision making questions. Do you agree? Should I miss this train? Are you not always focusing with that? Should I this one extra? Should I eat one more ice cream? Are you never coming across this? I think if you are sitting down for dinner, many a time it happens. You say, should I have little more? How much more then? So this is a part and parcel of your life and your everyday decisions. Marginal, little extra, little more. Yeah, Samir is putting it very nice, thoda aur chalega. So marginal revenue is that thoda aur, little more, till you are satisfied. So when we talk about here, it's marginal revenue. Yani ki kitna aur revenue company mein aa sakta hai. कितना और रेवेन्यू कंपनी को मिलेगा. आई वॉज जस्ट थिंकिंग अबाउट टूडेज दिस सलमान खान इंसिडेंट विच इज गोइंग अराउंड एंड ही इज गॉट दैट बेल. सो हाउ मच मोर डेज ऑफ फ्रीडम, दैट्स अगेन अ मार्जिनल कॉन्सेप्ट. एंड हाउ मच मोर रेवेन्यू कैन ही अर्न, हाउ मच मोर कैन ही एड टू हिज बैंक बैलेंस बाय साइनिंग और बाय कंप्लीटिंग द ऑलरेडी साइंड फिल्म्स. सो मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू इज दैट एडिशनल टाइम ही हैज गॉट, that additional money that he can make, that additional effort that he has to make, right? Sharmila, why you want to write down the formula now only? It's there in your book, but you can still write it down if you want to make some session notes, which will always remember, like you have attended this VCF, so some VCF notes. So this additional price is almost the same. If the price is not changing, then the price will remain the same. So marginal revenue formulas you have to know very well, students. There are two formulas given, and it is not your choice which to use. You have to be very clear that you will use the first formula only when the units are in order, like one after the other, in a sequence. So I'll give you some questions now. Okay, I'll just give you some very simple question. I'll type it and send you. 100 units giving rupees 1000. Okay. One second, let me type it. This does not come here, Rishikesh, ki units are homogeneous or differentiation. Isse koi farak nahi padta hai. Yahan par hum sirf revenue concept ko study kar rahe hain. Mathematically uska formula study kar rahe hain. So we are not concerned with the product's nature of the product. So okay, look at this question, students, which I've sent you. When a company is selling 100 units, it's making a total revenue of 1000. But when it is selling 101 unit, just one more, see the difference between the unit is of only one. So you will apply the first formula. How will you calculate it? Total revenue of 101 units minus total revenue of 100 units. वेरी गुड. ऐसा सिंपल क्वेश्चन एग्जाम में आ सकता है. इजी ना. नाउ यू वोंट से इको इज डिफिकल्ट. सो मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू इज 10. जस्ट द डिफरेंस 1000 एंड 10 माइनस 1000, सो दैट एडिशनल यूनिट इज सोल्ड फॉर रुपीज 10. नाउ आई विल गिव यू अनदर क्वेश्चन. जस्ट चेक द डिफरेंस. Yeah, just tell me now, what answer will you get? If you see here, what formula are you using now? Which formula are you using now from the given slide? Change in total revenue upon change in quantity. Why did you select the second formula, that is delta TR upon delta Q? Why did you select the second formula? Because the difference in the units was more than one. So keep this in mind, when the difference is more than one, you will use a second formula. Now directly taking you to slide number four, where Rishikesh, who was asking about whether the product is, now here we are connecting you, you have understood what is revenue, got it? Revenue ko kaise calculate karna hai. Now we are taking you to the understanding of how this revenue will be for the market. If it is a perfect competition or if it is a monopoly, is there going to be any differences in the revenues? To kya company ka revenue generation depends on its market structure. So you will find that in perfect competition, because there are many sellers and they are selling the same product, and very important, they cannot change the price. So there is one single price in which all the sellers have to sell the product, or iske liye the total revenue, average revenue or marginal revenue in perfect competition will be something like given on slide number 5. Look at the diagram. I think this is the first diagram that is coming to you after we started this chapters. It seems that diagrams have more impact in the mind than the calculation. If you look at the diagram, you will find there is a horizontal line. Yeah, that's right, Shweta. Second formula is correct. If you look in this diagram, students, the horizontal line, average revenue equal to marginal revenue. Answer is 50. Shweta is still calculating that previous marginal revenue. It will be 2000 minus 1000 divided by 120 minus 100. Okay, if you look at the slide number 5, it is AR equal to MR. There's a printing error. It is AR equal to MR. N stands for number of units. Sharmila is asking what does that N stands for in the formula which we all were calculating. That N stands for number of units. So TRN ka matlab hai TRN, number of units. That is 101. Okay, look at this. Yahan par aapko dikhega ki average revenue or marginal revenue horizontal hai. Or total revenue straight line upwards hai. इसका मतलब है परफेक्ट कंपटीशन में प्राइसेस नहीं बदलते. तो भले कंपनी 10 प्रोडक्ट बेचे या 11 प्रोडक्ट बेचे या 100 प्रोडक्ट्स बेचे, हर एक प्रोडक्ट पर मिलने वाला रेवेन्यू विल बी द सेम एज प्राइस. इसके लिए वो हॉरिजॉन्टल दे दिया है. सो व्हाट यू हैव टू रिमेंबर, एन माइनस वन का मतलब है 101 माइनस, या दैट्स राइट. ओके, कमिंग बैक टू दिस स्लाइड, यू विल फाइंड दैट दिस हॉरिजॉन्टल लाइन, Please remember this horizontal line, revenue line. Revenue line is called as the demand curve facing a perfect competitor. Why is it called as the demand curve facing a competitor? Because how much they want to sell will depend on the seller. One unit, two unit, three unit. Price is 100 rupees. Look at the diagram. Look at the diagram. The line is starting from 100. And on the x-axis, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Suppose if the seller is selling one product, let's say one pair of shoes for 100 rupees. Or one charger for 100 rupees. If he is selling 6 chargers, how much will he earn? If he is selling 600. If he sells 3 chargers, how much will he earn? समझ में आया? इसके लिए वो टीआर लाइन इज गोइंग अप. जितना आप ज्यादा बेचोगे उतना आपका रेवेन्यू बढ़ता जाएगा. I think all the channels are also today going after news and many for their increasing their TRP. The more they go ahead, the more their TRP increases, like this total revenue. It's just the formula. There's no need of equilibrium here. आप सिर्फ एक कॉन्सेप्ट सीख रहे हो, रेवेन्यू कॉन्सेप्ट, तो इक्विलिब्रियम यहाँ क्यों आएगा? आप सिर्फ देख रहे हो कि रेवेन्यू ग्राफ कैसे है कंपनी का. इक्विलिब्रियम इज डिमांड सप्लाई. ये सिर्फ डिमांड है, सप्लाई अभी तक आया ही नहीं है इधर. आप हम आपको सिर्फ बता रहे हैं कि कंपनी का रेवेन्यू कैसे दिखेगा इफ इट इज अ परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन. करेक्ट, ओके. नाउ वी गो अहेड. यहां पर आ गए आपका डिमांड और सप्लाई. तो वो लाइन जो हॉरिजॉन्टल लाइन था, दैट इज बिकॉज वो ही मार्केट प्राइस है. सो इफ इफ इट इट्स लाइक यू आर अ इन्वेस्टर, यू हैव परचेज सम शेयर्स ऑफ अ कंपनी. तो मार्केट प्राइस ऑफ शेयर्स, द प्राइस ऑफ शेयर्स विल चेंज अकॉर्डिंग टू द मार्केट डिमांड एंड सप्लाई. करेक्ट. तो अगर मार्केट का शेयर प्राइस कम होता है, यू बिकम व्हाट? अ प्राइस टेकर. यू हैव टू डिसाइड वेदर यू वांट टू सेल और नॉट. सो आर यू नॉट समवेयर लाइक दिस ग्राफ? इज योर सिचुएशन नॉट लाइक अ परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिटर वेर द प्राइस, यू आर अ प्राइस टेकर. सो हाउ इज दैट प्राइस डिसाइडेड? डिमांड एंड सप्लाई. सी दैट लाइन. सो दे हैव ड्रॉन अ डिमांड एंड अ सप्लाई एंड दैट इक्विलिब्रियम पॉइंट विच इज कॉल्ड एज अ मार्केट प्राइस. तो ये मार्केट प्राइस कौन डिसाइड करता है? The demand and the supply force. So just to make you understand that in a perfect competition, you will have large number of people who are investing in shares. You have n number of companies who are trading in shares. And you as an individual is like a perfect competitor. You are just a minute part in that whole market. If you decide tomorrow to exit from the share market, it will not fail. It will not crash down. It's only going to crash down when large number of people are going to take away their money. So what are we trying to make you understand is that in a perfect competition, one individual company will be just a minute fraction in the whole market. And they will be just like price takers. You decide whether you want to sell at that price or you don't want. Are you all there? Okay. We go ahead. I don't know whether students are getting lost or they are getting frustrated. Where are they? Good evening, Tanvi. Are sellers ko kya karna hai? Sellers wohi hai na? Aap seller ho, maine kaha. Agar aapko share bechna hai, you become a seller. Jab aapko khareedna hai, you become a buyer. तो दोनों सेलर और बायर का सिचुएशन एक ही है. दे आर ओनली प्राइस टेकर्स. यू आर वन पर्सन इन सो मेनी बायर्स हु इज बाइंग अ शेयर. इफ यू से नो 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 आई डोंट वांट टू बाय एट दिस प्राइस, दे विल से ओके फाइन. ऋषिकेश, सप्लायर प्राइस बढ़ा ही नहीं सकता है परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन में. ये चीज आपको दिमाग में डालना है क्योंकि देर आर एन नंबर. हम एक सेलर की बात कर रहे हैं. इन द डायग्राम वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ वन. या मनीष, डोंट वरी राजश्री, वॉट एवर यू आर अंडरस्टैंडिंग इज करेक्ट एंड यू आर क्रॉस क्वेश्चनिंग मी. लाइक ऋषिकेश सेड, इफ द सप्लायर इंक्रीजेस द प्राइस देन ही इज अफ्रेड दैट द डिमांड विल फॉल. बट आई एम टेलिंग यू दैट दिस इज परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन मार्केट. सेलर डज नॉट हैव द पावर टू डिसाइड द प्राइस. इनफैक्ट मेनी कंपनीज टूडे आर बिकमिंग लाइक परफेक्ट प्योर कॉम्पिटिटर्स. They are only price takers. And Sanjeevni, if there is a identical, if you are going to Fashion Street and there is a particular footwear which is sold at a higher price and the very next shop, the seller is selling the same footwear for a lower price, what would you prefer? Would you pay more money for a very identical pair which is given at a lower price? Definitely not. So that's what perfect competition is. Why will I pay more when I'm getting a similar product for a lower price somewhere else? Why quality comes now when it is a condition that the products are exactly homogeneous? You have to only go into the market where there is no product differentiation, neither in quality nor in color nor in whatever. Okay. Tanvi has given a good example. Paper plates. Paper plates will come under homogeneity. You buy it from any of the retail stores. They are almost same. Good. That's nice. See, like this, your ideas are coming up. Fantastic. That is what I like. You know, when students come up with instant thinking and with examples, that takes the flow of the lecture also more easily. Okay, we go ahead. Monopoly. When you talk about monopoly, now, please don't get confused. It is not monopolistic competition. It is monopoly, single seller. तो सिंगल सेलर है तो वो प्राइस टेकर होगा क्या? उसका रेवेन्यू ग्राफ परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिटर की तरह होगा? हेलो, क्या उसका? नो, डेफिनेटली नॉट. तो हम देखते हैं नेक्स्ट स्लाइड में कि मोनोपोली है तो उसका रेवेन्यू कैसे होगा. वो प्राइस डिसाइड कर सकता है. ओके, द फर्म इज अ प्राइस मेकर. दीज ऑल थिंग्स वी आर नॉट गोइंग इन डिटेल, देयर इज नो नीड. बट you will be surprised if you go to slide number 10. We have shown a downward sloping revenue graph for a monopoly. Can anybody tell me what does it mean? Look at slide number 10. The revenue average or marginal revenue are not same. Cost kyun aa raha hai abhi yahan par? Rishikesh, cost ka sawal hi nahi hai. Aapko revenue ko is only price at which you are selling. सबसे पहला डिफरेंस आपको क्या नजर आ रहा है? व्हाट इज द फर्स्ट डिफरेंस बिटवीन परफेक्ट कंपटीशन का रेवेन्यू ग्राफ एआरएमआर और इसका एआरएमआर? वेरी गुड. गिरीश तन्वी हैव सेड दैट मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू इज लोअर देन एवरेज रेवेन्यू, वेर एज इन परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन दे आर सेम. दिस इज बिकॉज इवन इफ यू आर अ मोनोपोली, you have to lower down the price in order to capture the market. Okay, if I just tell you that this downward sloping graph, it indicates that the highest price pay you cannot capture more of the market. So revenue ka matlab hai, if you want to sell more, you have to lower the price in order to capture the market. You may launch the product at a very highest price. He has to come down in the price because even if he's ruling the market, the price will be so high that he cannot capture the market share. At a higher price, he will be able to capture only a very small fraction of the market because everybody cannot afford to pay such a high price. Everybody will not be ready to buy the product at a higher price. And if you really look at the examples, you will find in case of India, most of these monopolies are enjoyed by public sector companies and not private. You know why? Because private sector companies, if they become monopolist, they will never lower down the price, which would be unjustifiable. And therefore, majority of the monopolies are still enjoyed by government companies. The government is still the decision maker. Yeah, hello. I think I've kept the mic really very close. If there's some hearing problem, I just want to ask other students, are you facing any problem? See, sometimes slow is all totally depending on. Okay, hello. I am to screaming over here. Even the next door can hear what I'm talking about. I don't know why students are okay. Are you able to hear me now? Okay. So, when we are talking about okay, so. Okay, so when we talk about coming back to slide number 10, if you look at slide number 10, Sharmila, I don't want you to calculate the same formula now. First, let's go with what this graph is talking about. Yeah, so I think Rocha, it's a problem with some of the students there, right? See, Rocha is saying that she can hear me very clearly. In fact, she has to reduce the volume at her PC because she cannot hear me. She's hearing me quite loud. Okay, he. I'm sorry. Rocha, what's your first name? Sigmund. That's how you pronounce? Okay. I'm sorry. Sharmila, I can't help it because you need to read it and then go ahead. Okay, so yeah, Shashank is sharing a very good information that he has read an article regarding Apple product, Apple's iPhone, which had a monopoly at a very huge margin. And that's monopoly. That's absolutely a monopoly example. And your Apple iPhone will come at the top, that letter Y. It launched the product at the highest price. So it will be that may be because it wants to capture a very prime segment of the buyers. Okay? So when the companies, now you'll relate this to what are the objectives of the company. If the objective of the company is only maximizing profit and not sales, then it will be only interesting in selling the product at the highest price. Because they believe lower the price, lower the quality. There are many, many things, many other factors which stops the company from bringing down the price. But yes, if they want to capture large number, if they want more people to start using Apple, then they need to little bit bring down the price to increase that customer segment. And Tanvi says that Apple does that when their products are already crossed the maturity phase. So basically this diagram somewhere gets applied. You take one particular iPhone model, see what time did it launch. Note the timing and the price, and then the same iPhone, if it has lowered the price, then when? And then you would connect those two points. I'm sure you'll get something like this falling revenue. Revenues will fall when the prices are lowered. Average revenue ka matlab hai price. Marginal revenue ka matlab hai additional product sold at a lower price. See, marginal revenue, like when you take the case of airlines. They are selling some tickets at a very lower price, which is called as advance booking. So when you go for an advance booking, on an average, you pay less price than what others are paying. The graph will be other way. So average revenue, but average revenue will be very high because they will be selling this advance booking only for a very few number of customers, maybe hardly 1% or even less. So if there are 500 people out of which 20 people are able to get the discount, then those 20 will come in MR. 20 tickets are sold at a lower price, correct? Whereas 480 tickets are sold at a higher price. So 480 ka average revenue is greater than 20 ka marginal revenue. So there are many, many ways in which you can, you know, keep relating. I need to go ahead. So revenue structure, you have understood. Okay, this all you need not study in detail, but just remember slide number 12. Slide number 12. Average revenue curve will never cut the x-axis. Iska matlab hai that the monopoly will never sell a product with zero price. It doesn't make sense. Can a monopoly sell a product free? So therefore, this is a technical explanation given to that. You can just avoid this. Don't go in detail for this. It's okay. You can finally go to the most important theory called objectives of the firm. Now, when will the company bring down the price? Will they keep the price at a very high? It all depends on the objectives and the what you can say, the goals of the company. So economists have given a theoretical topic called objectives of firm, where they are discussing about different objectives which the firms are facing. The very first is maximum profit. Here you will find that they are giving explanation I think I can, I will not go in detail of this theory topic, which my students can definitely take out time to read it. I will only give you the main idea and go more focus on something which is based on diagrams and formulas. Okay. In profit, this topic is purely giving you an idea that many a times companies do not want to maximize profit because they're afraid that they will attract government attention or they may be harming their goodwill. So many a times companies go for what is called as minimum profit rather than maximum profit. In fact, today maximum profit is not the goal. There are many other objectives which indirectly lead to more profit. So companies don't directly and openly say we want to maximize profit, but they use a other route, like they say we want to maximize sales. Interestingly, you will find that maximize sales se unka matlab hota hai maximum total revenue, price multiply by quantity, maximum total revenue. So companies are always looking at their revenue charts, how much revenues, how much sales target. So they give sales target to their salesmen. So which are the companies which are well known for their, I think all na, today in competition, everybody, even now when I told you that I came across this article of this Kishore Biyani about Big Bazaar, he's also forced to enter into competition because he wants to maximize his sales. Okay, we go ahead. Then you have quiet life and stable profits. Here the objective is that let the profits not be very high, very low, but let us keep it stable. That means for every year the target of your profit will be the same, if not more. This is found maximum with monopoly companies, state government companies. Look at the banks, the government banks, state banks. They always prefer to have something called as stable profits. But when it is private sector, they will never have quiet life and stable profits. There is so much of competition and so much of zeal to go ahead that they are not, they don't want to have a peaceful life, I think. I don't know how many of you working in private sector firms. Life is not peaceful. And you always say, oh, life is very peaceful for public sector employees. That's because their objectives differ. Most of the private sector companies believe in long run survival and growth. They don't want to go for short run profits. So many times companies put lot of efforts, lot of R&D to create a brand image and a goodwill among their customers. Companies well known for their after sales product. I mean, it's just a proverb, you know, people can just close their eyes and buy the product. So much is the quality of the product. They need not even bother about the price. So which are the companies which are today well known for their quality products? You have Tata, you have Apple, Sony, Colgate. Yes, so these are long run survival. One more thing which students have to remember is that long run survival, may I want you to remember and think of those companies which are here from last 40 to 50 years. Their brand has not changed. The same brand, they are selling the product under the same brand. And even customers today are saying, yes, this is what? Cadbury, good. That's an example of long-run survival and growth. Parle G, very good. Procter & Gamble, agreed. Okay, Godrej, yes. In fact, they are well-known for their specialized products. Like Parle G is still well-known for its glucose brand, which is very difficult to compete. Good. So we go ahead. We'll go to the next objective, which is called as growth maximization. When you talk about growth maximization, now I find that majority of the students are giving example depending on the products which they might be using. So you need to keep on reading the newspapers to find out which are the companies which are well known. It's any new company, even if it comes, even if it makes a substitute, it cannot, customers will go back to that company's product. That's called long run survival and growth. Maggi, Wipro, Nescafe. I don't know whether Nescafe, I find that Nescafe is slowly losing ground. There are n number of coffee brands which are comparatively better. No? What Sanjeevni and what others have to say? Is Nescafe able to retain that brand? I can find that Nestle products in terms of dairy whitener, they are still... See, these are different objectives, Girish. It all depends on the companies. It all depends on the company which objective they want to prefer. You are studying this objective from the point that each company may stick to one objective and work. So you are trying to understand the particular intention behind company's behavior based on its objective. Okay, we are going ahead. Growth maximization. When can a company grow? How do you know that the company is growing? Even if you're not working in that company. Okay, very interesting. Very interesting in this slide, the last paragraph, share value. The growth of a company is very closely associated with its market share value. Okay, so whenever it comes to growth maximization, this model believes that the market value of the company's shares will decide how much the company is growing. Okay, there are many other short-term alternative objectives. When you talk about balance sheet homeostasis, I think many of you know what is the auditing time and how pressurized you are because it is the auditing month. So that's one of the most important reason. No, this won't be the last chapter, Jose. You can have a cup of coffee along with the further slides. We need to complete four chapters. Yes? So when you talk about this balance sheet homeostasis, it means it is one of the most basic condition for all the firms. Homogeneous, statistically, which they have to maintain. So homeostasis is homogeneously statistical method, which like auditing, it is one of the statistical method which is to be followed homogeneously by all the firms. Auditing, filing returns, IT returns. Behavioral theory believes in various goals which the company has. Utility theory believes in keeping a balance between maximization of the staff along with customer satisfaction, like what you call as customer help desk. Today, customer help desk has come up with maximum of our companies. That's utility index theory, which means giving the maximization benefit to the customer, and company doesn't mind in adding more staff as long as they are able to meet their customers. Okay? See, neither of these approaches, read this slide, neither of these approaches produced an alternative which has sustained recognition to replace the traditional theory of firm. These are all alternative objectives. But one of the most important objective is that yes, companies are working for profit at the end of the day. They are interested in their cost and in their revenues. Finally, what is the tool that the company used to predict their profit? Break-even analysis. It's purely a formula. You just have to remember this formula. What is the formula? Total fixed cost divided by price minus variable cost. So kindly remember this formula and rest you can do on your own. It's just the a chart which is given to you. So it's purely talking about break-even point where total revenue and total cost are equal. Total revenue and total cost are equal. So rest is self-study. I think I can quickly say move to the next chapter. In break-even analysis, only do the formula and the meaning. Rest, it's self-explanatory. So I can take little bit of benefit and quickly move to the next chapter. Okay. Okay, So we are moving to chapter number 11, break-even analysis based on the formula. Fixed cost upon selling price minus variable cost per unit. Now this chapter, many of you will find it difficult because it's only based on diagram and some conditions. It's a theoretical concept based on your chapter number 9, markets. Now in the markets, you have n number of companies and each company have different objectives. And out of those all objectives, we are picking up one objective called profit maximization. What should the company do if it wants to make profit? How do you explain it in a mathematical way using some formulas? So this chapter is only giving you a formula to decide what would be the company's profit maximization output. And then the formula is also giving you an idea about something called as equilibrium. What is this equilibrium? Equilibrium means where the company's decision, it's satisfied with its decision, whatever it has taken with respect to sale, output, price. And it doesn't want to deviate from its decision. In fact, equilibrium under profit maximization means, how do we come to this heading of this chapter? So to understand that, first, let us look at what is profit. How does a company make profit? What is the formula of profit? So I give you a formula, I write it, I type it, and I give it here. Okay. अरे वाह, स्टूडेंट्स को आता है, वेरी गुड. टोटल रेवेन्यू माइनस टोटल कॉस्ट, करेक्ट. नाउ टोटल रेवेन्यू फॉर परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन एंड फॉर इम्परफेक्ट मोनोपोली विल नॉट बी द सेम. व्हाई विल द टोटल रेवेन्यू नॉट सेम फॉर मोनोपोली और फॉर परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन? नाउ यू हैव टू नो प्रॉफिट एंड वी हैव टू कनेक्ट प्रॉफिट विद मार्केट्स. वी हैव टू नो हाउ द कंपनीज, each individual seller will make profit depending on the market structure. No, marketing cost is totally different. Of course, advertisement is there, but still, prices are different. That's right, Tanvi. So, let's take you back to what you studied in chapter number 9. To understand that, we will take you to two different concepts. First concept is, to get maximum profit, apply the formula total revenue minus total cost. Okay, understood? Now, if it is perfect competition, the economists have used diagram to make you understand. Slide number 3 shows you a very straight 45 degree line going from 0 called as total revenue line. Jitna zyada bechoge, utna zyada revenue aayega. क्योंकि आप प्राइस को बदल नहीं सकते हो. अब इस टोटल रेवेन्यू लाइन पे हम टोटल कॉस्ट ड्रॉ करते हैं. इफ यू सी, टोटल कॉस्ट को ऐसे फिश टाइप फॉर्म में ड्रॉ किया है बिकॉज दिस डायग्राम इज ट्राइंग टू मेक यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट इनिशियली व्हेन यू आर इन बिजनेस, व्हेन एनी सेलर इज स्टार्टिंग टू सेल, हिज फिक्स्ड कॉस्ट आर वेरी हाई. Fixed costs are very high. So he has to find out first his break-even point. Minimum that he has to manufacture, he has to produce, he has to sell to cover up his fixed cost and variable cost. And that point is shown as OZ. So what does this point OZ tell you? What is OZ? OZ is the break-even volume of output. B is the break-even point. After the break-even point, you enter into what is called as profit region. Profit region. Because your costs are going down. Costs are going down. Fixed costs are going down. Because you are increasing output, fixed cost gets divided. Even though the variable cost is increasing, it's both. Fixed plus variable. Now, what is the condition of maximum profit that we should select, we should stop if it's a, if the seller, if the company wants to only make maximum profit, then it should stop at point OM. T1, T2 is a tangent drawn, क्योंकि वो स्लोप है ना, तो वो टेंजेंट ड्रॉ किया है टू फाइंड आउट द एग्जैक्ट वर्टिकल डिस्टेंस बिटवीन टोटल कॉस्ट एंड टोटल रेवेन्यू, वेयर दिस वर्टिकल डिस्टेंस इज मैक्सिमम. सो इफ द कंपनी वॉन्ट्स टू मेक मैक्सिमम प्रॉफिट, इट विल स्टॉप एट ओ एम, बिकॉज आफ्टर ओ एम यू विल सी दैट द रीजन इज बिकमिंग नैरो. नैरो का मतलब है दैट यू आर कॉम्प्रोमाइजिंग विद प्रॉफिट एंड टोटल कॉस्ट इज राइजिंग. फाइन. नाउ नाउ वी मूव टू इम्परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन. यू विल फाइंड दैट इन केस ऑफ इम्परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन, लेट्स से मोनोपोली और मोनोपोलिस्टिक कॉम्पिटिशन, द कंपनीज हैव द पावर ओवर प्राइस एंड इन ऑर्डर टू सेल मोर दे विल ब्रिंग डाउन द प्राइस एंड देयर फॉर द टोटल रेवेन्यू ग्राफ इज स्लोपिंग. इट्स नॉट अ 45 डिग्री स्ट्रेट लाइन, इट्स नॉट अ प्रपोर्शनल, क्योंकि आपका रेवेन्यू सेम प्रपोर्शन में नहीं बढ़ता है. अगेन द सेम थिंग, प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन आउटपुट विल बी ओ एम वन. तो ये दोनों डायग्राम में एक ही डिफरेंस आपको ऑब्जर्व करना है, टोटल रेवेन्यू. परफेक्ट कॉम्पिटिशन है तो टोटल रेवेन्यू विल बी अ 45 डिग्री स्ट्रेट लाइन. वो तभी होगा जब रेवेन्यू सेम प्रपोर्शन में बढ़ेगा. हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हैव यू ऑल गॉन टू स्लीप? आई कैन फाइंड ओनली तन्वी रिस्पॉन्डिंग. ओके ग्रेट. एंड वेन यू टॉक अबाउट इम्परफेक्ट in monopoly, you will find that the total revenue graph is sloping downwards because the revenues will not increase in the same proportion because prices are lowered, but the condition applies is the same. Stop where the difference between total revenue and total cost is highest. To ye hua profit maximization ka mathematical explanation. Now I take you to slide 6, which I have prepared, where I want the students to look at this slide and tell me which is the quantities given in the very first column. Let's say it is tons of fishes or tons of steel. Which is the profit maximization ton of steel? You have to find out the output, where the difference between total cost and total revenue will be the highest. So where the difference between total cost and total revenue is highest, this you will have to calculate. I'll tell you, select 3, 4, and 5. Out of this 3, tell me which. Swaroop, what is the difference you are getting? 390 minus 243. Total revenue minus total cost. 390 is the total revenue from selling 5 tons. 243 is the total cost. So is it 4 or is it 5? Okay. 312 minus 189. तो कहां प्रॉफिट ज्यादा है? प्रॉफिट ज्यादा सबसे हाईएस्ट किसमें है? 5. सो 5 विल बी कॉल्ड एज अ प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन आउटपुट. नाउ वी आर टेकिंग यू टू सम अदर कॉन्सेप्ट. इज प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन ऑल्सो द इक्विलिब्रियम? सपोज आई एम राइटिंग दिस क्वेश्चन. I have asked you a question. Is the profit maximization output also the equilibrium condition? Now, when you are asked a question on profit and equilibrium, you have to remember, students, for equilibrium, you have to apply this second rule given on slide number 7. अप्लाइंग मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू विद मार्जिनल कॉस्ट. इसका मतलब है इफ द मार्जिनल कॉस्ट इज इंटरसेक्टिंग द मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू एंड बोथ आर इक्वल देन इट इज इक्विलिब्रियम पॉइंट. लुक एट दिस स्लाइड नंबर 10. Look at slide number 10. You will understand it very clearly. You will find that the profit is maximum for 250 products. 29,400. And for 300 products also the profit is 29,400. So the maximum profit is 29,400 for 250 and 300. Now should the company stop at 250 or should they go for 300? Should they make 50 products more? See, their profits are not changing. That is where you will apply the concept of marginal cost with marginal revenue. If you look, the marginal cost for 250, it is 22. Marginal cost, it is 22. So when the marginal cost is less, it means even if you are making an extra product, you will not add more to your cost. You will add more to your revenue. क्योंकि मार्जिनल कॉस्ट मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू इज शोइंग यू द डिफरेंस इन द टोटल कॉस्ट एंड टोटल रेवेन्यू. व्हेन द कंपनी मेक्स द नेक्स्ट 50 प्रोडक्ट्स दैट इज 300 प्रोडक्ट्स इट्स मार्जिनल कॉस्ट बिकम्स 25. इट्स मार्जिनल कॉस्ट बिकम्स 25. इट्स मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू ऑल्सो बिकम्स 25. सो व्हेन मार्जिनल कॉस्ट एंड मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू 25 इक्वल टू 25 इट्स इक्वल. It is called as equilibrium under profit maximization. Why 250? When you can add more to your revenue without affecting your profit, aapke profit pe to farak nahi pad raha hai. So why don't you make another 50 products? It's like you will add 25 rupees more in your revenue and you will add more to your cost also. There the revenue is more, 75 is more. You are, आपका cost 250 first product बनाने का cost है 22 रुपए. लेकिन आप उसको market में बेचोगे आपको 75 rupees मिलेगा. So what you think? चलो थोड़े और products बनाते. इसका मतलब है हर एक product पर on a margin, marginal profit बोलते हैं इसको. तो 22 rupees आपका cost है और 75 rupees revenue है. तो कितना हुआ difference? इसका मतलब हर एक प्रोडक्ट पे आपका मार्जिनल प्रॉफिट इंक्रीज हो रहा है. तो जब तक वो मार्जिनल प्रॉफिट स्टॉप ना हो जाए, यू विल गो ऑन मेकिंग द प्रोडक्ट टिल यू रीच अ पॉइंट कॉल्ड 300, जहां पर आपका मार्जिनल रेवेन्यू और मार्जिनल कॉस्ट इज इक्वल. सो दिस इज व्हाट वी हैव कवर्ड. द गोल्डन रूल ऑफ इक्विलिब्रियम इज इफ द कंपनी इज मेकिंग प्रॉफिट, इट हैज टू ऑल्सो लुक इन टू कंसिडरेशन अ गोल्डन रूल which is necessary for equilibrium called equating the marginal cost with marginal revenue. Now we move on to the last chapter for today's session, which is chapter number 12. Okay. Well, the last and the final chapter for today's session is chapter number 12. Sanjay, that slide is already, we have uploaded the next slide. What you wanted to ask of the previous slide? Yeah, Tanvi, I'll send you the link. Okay. So the last chapter, which is talking about all these conditions. Yeah, Sanjay, you had anything to ask about that chapter? No? Okay. Now this chapter may, the most important thing that you will be taught in this chapter, this all you can avoid. This all diagrams are just not there. This diagram I have deliberately put in. I wanted the students to see some difference where I wanted the students to use a new concept called, I'll write it here. I want the students to just understand the role of average revenue and average cost, because that is the thing which we have not discussed yet. In the previous chapter, we talked about total revenue, total cost, marginal revenue, marginal cost. But we did not discuss what is the role of average revenue with average cost. So just to make them understand, I've used this slide. If you look in this slide, in the first diagram, you will see that average total cost graph shown at point B. It is below the average revenue line. Ye perfect competition ka diagram hai. You can't see the slide. Slide number 4 of chapter 12. Okay. Can you see the slide 4 of chapter 12? Other students? Okay. Why is it blank, Tanvi? I don't think so. Is the slide blank of chapter 4? No, many are saying no. The PPT only I'm talking about. Fourth slide of chapter 4. There's a diagram, three diagrams. If you see the very first diagram, yeah, the graph, you will see that the average total cost, that is point B, it's below the average revenue. MR likha hai, AR nahi likha hai, wo understood hai. Kyunki perfect competition hai, that horizontal line is only the P. P ka matlab hai average revenue. So what is happening is, agar average total cost, average revenue se kam hai, so we say the company is making on an average super normal profit. So ye term, naya term aaya hai, which is called as, I'll type it here. Super normal profit. This term is just to make you understand that on an average, if the average revenue is more that the company is getting, थोड़ा बहुत लॉस होगा, थोड़ा बहुत दे में लीव द कस्टमर्स और दे में हैव टू सेल सम प्रोडक्ट्स फ्री आल्सो, बट ऑन एन एवरेज अगर उनका कॉस्ट कवर होता है प्राइस में, देन दे आर मेकिंग सुपर नॉर्मल प्रॉफिट. बट इफ देयर कॉस्ट स्टार्ट्स इंक्रीजिंग, लाइक यू सेड, एडवर्टाइजमेंट एक्सपेंसेस, प्रोडक्शन एक्सपेंसेस, मटीरियल, एंड देयर एवरेज टोटल कॉस्ट इंक्रीजेस, बट स्टिल इफ इट इज इक्वल टू देयर एवरेज रेवेन्यू, if I'm writing it here, I'm giving you the three conditions which I've drawn in this diagram. These are the three conditions which this diagram is reflecting. Sorry. If the, see, the first two diagrams show that the company will survive. Even if the company, In the third diagram, what is happening? Yeah, in the third diagram, there is a split. You will find that the AVC, that is average variable cost, is down. यानी कि अगर आपकी कंपनी वेरिएबल एक्सपेंसेस कवर करती है, एज लॉन्ग एज यू कवर अप योर वेरिएबल एक्सपेंसेस, लाइक यू आर एबल टू पे द पेमेंट ऑफ योर लेबरर्स एम्प्लॉयज, यू आर एबल टू पे मेक द पेमेंट फॉर द रॉ मटेरियल सप्लायर्स, यू कैन स्टिल सर्वाइव इवन विद पार्शियल लॉस पार्शियल प्रॉफिट. वेन डज द शट डाउन स्टेज कम्स, लाइक किंगफिशर एयरलाइंस. किंगफिशर एयरलाइंस वॉज वंस इन द फर्स्ट पैनल, मैक्सिमम प्रॉफिट दे वर मेकिंग ऑन एन एवरेज. Then what happened? Their cost starts rising or their revenue started dropping. So they found that they were able to just meet what is called as the break-even, normal profit. But the time came when they were not able to pay the fixed cost. They were in a loss, but still they could. This is slide number 4. Still they were able to keep flying. But they had to shut down when they did not have that much of also revenue to cover up their variable expenses. So business is all about ups and downs, and the companies need to always remember. Yeah, Kiran is saying now they'll come back again. That's a positive response. So this is what it's all about. This is same monopoly. We can avoid this. We have to directly go to, this is the same repetition. This is the same repetition. The second condition is called as normal profit. Second condition is called as normal profit. Okay. Now, when you talk about elasticity of demand, what is elasticity of demand? It is responsiveness of a customer to the price. So in monopoly, it's very important that when a monopolist is deciding the price of the product, then the company should understand the economic term called elasticity of demand. If the elasticity is greater than one ka matlab hai, people are going to respond to a price change of a monopoly, like Apple. Apple comes under very strong price elasticity. There are many who want to buy that product, but they find the price is too high. So the moment they find Apple is bringing down a little bit, you know, price, they will quickly go and buy it. That is called sensitivity towards the price of a very prime product or a product of a monopoly. So monopoly kya karte hai, wo log aise hi market mein enter karte hai, where they will find that they are able to earn maximum revenue. And if the elasticity is less than one ka matlab hota hai necessity product like salt, Indian Railways, the monopolist will not be able to enjoy profit because it's a necessity product. They cannot increase the price. So these are some technical things. You can avoid that. This I leave you for self-study, a comparison between perfect competition and monopoly. I request you can go to your study material. Whatever we have studied till now, we have taken one point to make the students. You can, this is just this is just the difference between perfect competition and monopoly. I will be repeating the same things which we have done in chapter 9. So we will move away from here. The most important topic, taking you to slide number 19. If you look at slide number 19, we are taking a special pricing behavior of a monopoly, which is called price discrimination. Now, many students were asking, if he is a monopoly, why he should bring down the price. Monopoly, what he does is he tries to discriminate in price. That's the only way a monopolist can capture the market also and make maximum profit also. Now, there are three ways in which a monopolist can discriminate price. One, personal. Second, regional. Third, trade. Personal price discrimination you will find common, very common. Like if you take an example of a ticket price for a senior citizen, an adult and a child, you will find there's a difference. Senior citizens, only in case of rail, there are some concessions given. That's called personal, because they do not, they are not, they are not earning a very high income, or they are not income earners. I'm talking of children and people above 60. They are dependents. So they are given that relaxation. That's called personal price discrimination. IT return relaxation on the basis of gender. Regional are purely based on MRP, based on area. Like most of you might have seen that there are a lot of products like foods, biscuits, bread, which outside Maharashtra, the prices are different. Within Maharashtra, they are different. That's regional, region wise. And taxes also will come under regional. Taxes do have an impact on pricing. In fact, that's the reason why prices differ many a times. But monopolists take that advantage. Trade price discrimination is where you will find that the prices are differed on the purpose of the product. Like for example, LPG. LPG for domestic use and LPG for industrial use. The rates will differ. The price per LPG cylinder is different. So this is purely done, and you find a lot of examples. But very important is that when can a monopolist practice this? Are there some conditions required? Yes. There are many conditions which are required for price discrimination, which will take you from slide 19 of this chapter 12. First, monopoly kis mein aata hai? Perfect competition mein ya imperfect mein? In the beginning of chapter 9, I said that markets are divided into perfect and so imperfect. Therefore, sabse pehla condition hai ki imperfect competition hona chahiye. Second condition hai, resale possibility nahi hona chahiye. Varna I will buy in a market where the prices are lower and then sell it where I can sell it at a higher price. Jisko hum bolte hai speculation, or what is called as taking the advantage of this market. Yes. So resale possibility nahi hona chahiye. Correct. Oil, consumable. Yes, arbitrage is the right word. Then elasticity of demand different hona chahiye. Elasticity ka matlab hai logon ka sensitivity. Poor people will be more sensitive to price than rich people. People living in rural areas are more sensitive to price than people living in cities. Area wise also sensitivity differs depending on the crowd, age group. So this elasticity has to be understood and accordingly practiced. Then understanding the consumer differences. Are the consumers indifferent? Unko farak nahi padta hai for thoda bahut changes in price. Like for example, if you want to get a printout in your area, there may be a cyber cafe where the printout will be very expensive. Per page they will be charging you 2 rupees. But if you go all the way kilometers away to the station, they are charging you 1 rupee, and you want to only take a printout of 4 pages. What would you do? Will you go all the way, or will you pay, you don't mind paying little more? You understand, this is called minor differences, where people are, they are aware and they are ready to pay a higher price. So these are some of the examples where price discrimination is possible for the monopolist or the sellers. And all those who are offering these personal services like hair salons, boutiques, beauty parlors, doctors, lawyers, all of them are found to be practicing price discrimination based on their customers. Basically segmenting the market and the customers and then deciding the prices. Very, very useful for the company to maximize profit also and maximize sales also. Now, our economists are never tired of diagrams. So wherever they get an opportunity, they try to use diagrams. And one of that is done here, where concept of price discrimination is explained to the students using some assumption and a model. Taking you to slide number 26. There are two different markets. And in these two different markets, the customer sensitivity is shown in the form of a diagram. But there are some conditions. Like you should only take two markets. You should take a monopoly company. And you should remember that there are two different types of markets with two different type of customers. One, who are not ready to buy the product at higher price. Whereas other market, people don't mind paying a higher price. So how our customer, how our monopoly distributes his output in the two markets? Slide number 28. How does a monopolist distribute the output in this two market? So this is a theory. It's a model. First, you need to understand that. So you go back to output. How does the monopoly decide how much to sell? It will depend on his marginal cost and marginal revenue. Additional cost, additional revenue. He will go on making the product till the cost of making the last product is equal to the revenue earned from selling that product. So let's say it's Reliance Energy. Now Reliance Energy is a monopoly after, okay. And Reliance Energy has got its output OM given in slide number 29 diagram. OM is called as equilibrium output. This output has to be distributed. देखो यहाँ पर हम बात कर रहे हैं कि कंपनी अपना आउटपुट डिसाइड करती है, लेकिन जब उसको डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करने की बात आती है और उसका प्राइस, when the price has to be decided, then how does a monopolist use this concept of price discrimination? So the economist have drawn two diagrams, one with a very steep slope, ऐसे वो एकदम steep है, थोड़ा vertical है first वाला, और second वाला flatter है. So one is very steep and other is very flatter. Steep का मतलब है people are less sensitive to price. उनके लिए product ज्यादा important है than price. Like electricity. We don't mind paying a higher electricity bill, but we are very much prone to time saving electrical gadgets, whether it's a washing machine, it's a mixer driver, it's a iron, it's a television set, it's a laptop, it's a mobile. We are prone to consuming more and more electrical electricity because of electrical gadgets, refrigerators, AC. लेकिन आप गांव में जाओ तो पीपल आर वेरी सेंसिटिव टू प्राइस एंड दे विल ओनली प्रेफर टू यूज व्हाट आर वेरी नेसेसरी. तो पावर ऐसे डिस्ट्रीब्यूट होता है कि पर्टिकुलर यूनिट का जो रेट होता है, यूनिट कंजम्पशन और रेट, वो डिफरेंशिएट किया जाता है. आर यू अंडरस्टैंडिंग? ओके, सो हाउ टू शो इट इन द डायग्राम, ये तो हमें समझ में आ गया, बट उसको डायग्राम में हम कैसे प्रूव करें, हम कैसे दिखाएं कि प्राइस डिस्क्रिमिनेशन यहाँ दिखाई दे रहा है. सो इफ यू सी योर स्टूडेंट्स, द फर्स्ट डायग्राम यू कैन सी द प्राइस इज हायर एंड इन द सेकेंड डायग्राम द प्राइस इज लोअर, दैट P1, P2. दैट्स जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ द स्लोप. अगर स्लोप ऐसे रहेगा तो प्राइस हायर मिलेगा, ऐसे रहेगा तो प्राइस लोअर. सो यू आर प्रूविंग that elasticity and price differences can be shown in the diagram. You can kindly go through this, draw this diagram, practice it at home, and then let me know if you are still facing a problem here. For the time being, I take you to the next slide, slide number 30, which is called dumping. Dumping is also one type of price discrimination. Only thing is that dumping comes under international level. That means when other countries or when any other company of any other country is selling a product at a lower price, then it is called dumping. So dumping is selling a product in a foreign market at a price lower than its home market. Which example comes to your mind in case of dumping? Okay, Amway can be dumping. You will always see this happening in newspapers also. You will read that if our government increases the tax on some products, then that would invite dumping. Other countries will be willing to sell the product at a lower price in India because they know they can capture the Indian market. That's what's done in case of China products. Yeah. Phones, which you're talking about, Flipkart, Steel, China, these are perfect examples of dumping and it's very, very popular. There are many reasons why dumping is supported. You can just self-study that. Dumping is specially, Gujarat. Producing goods in Gujarat and selling is also can be called as, no, this cannot be called as dumping because it is not a foreign market, Tanvi. It's within, it's a domestic market. So it's like just taking, it's called as price discrimination, Tanvi. It will come under price discrimination. Dumping term has to be only used for a foreign product. And that also, if it is sold at a lower price than its home country. Okay, we moved to a very interesting market, which most of the students were asking the question right from the beginning, monopolistic competition. They're always confused between monopoly and monopolistic competition. Monopolistic competition is a market where you will find a combination of perfect competition and monopoly. As I said, most of the FMCG companies come here. These are some of the features. The most strongest feature is that they have to spend a lot on advertisement. So selling costs are considered to be the highest. Yeah, monopoly is one and monopolistic is many sellers. Selling cost and production cost differences are given. Selling cost has to be not considered as production cost. And selling cost is mostly reflecting the demand side, whereas production cost is reflecting the supply side. So there's a big difference between marketing, advertisement and production. Production is considered essential. Selling cost is not essential. You have to spend money on advertisement only if you have a fear that your competitor will capture the market. And today you find that even insurance companies have entered into more and more of selling cost. There was a time, and even today, I think LIC is a monopoly. GIC is a monopoly, but what about Max Life? What about ICICI Prudential? Are they not spending a lot on selling cost? Because they know that the people will not easily move over to these new entrants with LIC enjoying a monopoly power. So they are entering into the market with more and more of advertisements. Now, based on selling cost, there has been a lot of debate, which you see on slide number 36. There are some who are of the opinion that selling cost is a waste. And there is a group of thinkers who believe that selling cost is not a waste. So this is the most easiest topic which you can study on your own. Now coming to slide number 37, diagrams. Whenever it comes to diagrams, our students get panic. This diagram is purely drawn to make you understand that like monopoly, even in monopolistic competition, the average revenue and marginal revenue will be downward sloping. Look at the telecom, look at the companies which are drastically bringing down the prices of durable products to sell them. You can even take examples of one day Vijay Sales offer or E-Zone coming up with some type of discounts. These are even today, most of these supermarket stores are coming up with a lot of discounts to attract the buyers. So that's what? That's on an average bringing down the price to maximize the sale. Like you have that Wednesday Big Bazaar sale. So these are all the ways. You have Food Bazaar, you have so Reliance Fresh, and you have many competitors, but still they are forced to advertise, they are forced to come up with discount offers in order to add more to their revenue. So that diagrams, there's a difference. Huh? Just see this difference. In 37, the diagram on slide 37, you will find average cost is below average revenue. Whereas here it has gone up so that there's no profit. So if the cost on an average goes up, the company will have to compromise with its profit and only concentrate on selling the product. Finally, we come to the last market of this chapter, which is called oligopoly. It is a market of few sellers. Like telecom will come here. Travel and tourism will come here. You have only few companies. Airlines will come here. What happens when there are few sellers? Are they not going to be rivals of each other? Because everybody wants to capture more market share. So how do you know in oligopoly who is a dominant player? So when you take, let's say, if you take five different airlines, Indigo, Jet Airways, Go Air, Air Asia, you will find that there will be some who will have a larger market share compared to the other. This describes the oligopoly war, oligopoly situation. On that basis, The oligopoly is divided into different types. Pure, where you have few sellers, but all are selling the same product like steel, cement, oil. Product to standardized hai. तो ये सबको हम क्या बोलेंगे? प्योर ऑलिगोपली. फिर ऑलिगोपली डिफरेंशिएटेड कब होगा? जब उनका प्रोडक्ट इज टोटली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द अदर. आई वॉन्ट टू आस्क यू स्टूडेंट्स, वेन यू टेक द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ एयरबस एंड बोइंग, इज देर अ टोटल डिफरेंस इन द डिजाइनिंग ऑफ देयर एयरक्राफ्ट मैन्युफैक्चर? क्या वो दोनों टोटली डिफरेंट है या दे आर ऑलमोस्ट सेम स्टैंडर्डाइज्ड? If it is standardized, then it will be called pure oligopoly, duopoly. Differentiated hoga telecom service provider, Tata Docomo, Vodafone, Airtel. It's almost different. They are almost different with their schemes, with the time when they are giving their schemes. Even services, airline services will come under differentiated oligopoly. Open and closed oligopoly basically means whether the licenses which are given to these oligopolists are free. When oligopolists are free to enter, like telecom. Telecom comes under open oligopoly because it is free to enter the market, but to get 3G and 4G spectrum, it's difficult. Even when you talk about beverages, liquor and beverages and cigarette, they again come in closed oligopoly because it's not easy to acquire that license. So that's an example of closed oligopoly. But many a times it has found that in this market, there may be one company which may enter the market with one of the best pricing strategy, which Tata Docomo did. It entered the market with 1 paise per second plan. And what happened? Everybody followed. So Tata Docomo came under what is called as partial oligopoly. Partial ka matlab hota hai, to snatch the market and capture the attention of the customers to one side. So that's how it became a price leader. Suddenly everybody was concentrating there. And then others were afraid they will lose the market. So they also followed and they converted this partial oligopoly into full. They all followed that strategy. Now this situation of this following the leader and trying to snatch others' market and competing on prices is very well explained by an economist called Paul Sweezy. Given on page slide number 42. Oligopoly mein ye jo price war hota hai ek dusre se, you know, they are always fighting. That situation is understood and it is shown in the form of a diagram which is peculiarly called as kinked demand curve. Kinked demand curve means, according to the economist, a oligopolist will never face that standard downward sloping graph. There will be this jerk, this kink. This means that when you increase the price, others will not follow you. When you decrease the price, they will copy you. So they don't let you win. You cannot win the market by increasing the price. You cannot make more money. Nor can you make more money by bringing down the price and capturing the market. So you are in a situation where your prices remain almost in one particular category. You can neither go up nor go down. Because your rivals are immediately looking at your, watching your pricing behavior. So this is one of the worst part of oligopoly market, which is called as price war. And therefore, what they do is they make a cartel, they make a group. They say, come on, let's not fight with each other. That's what is done in case of opaque. And this was done, yeah, even real estates can do that. So that's what we can... If they are not ready for the cartel, then they'll keep fighting either on price or on sales, on marketing, price war or non-price war. It's up to them. So that covers your entire 12 chapter 12, 9, 10, 11, 12. And I think we are ready for the MCQ for these chapters. These multiple choice questions are not your internal test. These marks will not go in the exam. It is only to know whether whatever I have taught you and whatever you have listened for so much time, are you in a position to give a on-the-spot test? Fine. So that's it. We will be sending you the MCQs of these questions. Fine. Shall I start from chapter 9 or shall I start from chapter 12? Because it will be fresh in your mind. What? Come on, tell me. Okay, that's fine. Okay, the first question is, economists have broadly classified market structure on the basis of competition into how many categories? You have to only give one answer, huh? The second question is, how many conditions are necessary for pure competition? I think Rishikesh should answer this. He was asking maximum questions on this now. The third question is, which of the following products is most suitable for very short period market? Fourth question, which is the last for this particular chapter, supply is perfectly elastic in which of the following time elements? This was the last slide of chapter 9. Okay, now we'll discuss the answers. You can cross-check yourself. First question, your answer was 2. Perfect and imperfect competition, because the question is asking broadly classification, okay? Second, your question was how many conditions? We have clearly given you in the slide 3 conditions: large number of buyers and sellers, homogeneous product, free entry and exit. So your answer is 3. Third question, very short period market. Very short was the first. So your answer has to be out of all this, which is the most perishable product, carrots. So your answer is 2. And fourth question, perfectly elastic. The answer is 4. Even if you have written 3, it's right. 3 and 4 both applies to perfectly elastic market. Very good. Now we give you the MCQ for chapter number 10. The first question from chapter 10 is that the revenue facing perfect competition is what? Now remember, perfectly elastic means horizontal, perfectly inelastic means vertical. This is taught to you in Elasticity of Demand, chapter 4. It has to be horizontal, okay? The second question is the relation between AR and MR under monopoly is such that. How do you find the AR and MR in monopoly? Third question, there's a case study. This had come in the Economic Times newspaper. More than 90-year-old United Nilgiri Tea Estates is producing 500 kg of white tea annually and is selling it at rupees 10,000 per kg. So you have to know that this statement is reflecting which concept? Fourth question, which is the last question for this break-even analysis, break-even point formula. What is the break-even point formula? Okay, we'll see where the answers are. Majority of your answers were one. Revenue under perfect competition is perfectly elastic. If it's horizontal, it's called perfectly elastic. Your second question. Okay, the second question also your answer was one because marginal revenue is below average revenue. Then your third question. I don't know how many of you were able to get this answer. Price is given, quantity is given. Price into quantity, the formula of total revenue. Your answer is fourth, D. And the last question, your answer is first. Total revenue equal to total cost. So that covers your four questions. Do you want me to stop now? This was just an idea given to you on how the questions can be. So this will help you to study. Okay. So with that, we wind up today's session and I hope you will do well. So you can keep on reading and it's great to have you here. All the best. We meet you next time when we will be. I don't know. I don't have any Facebook link or anything like that. So you can create a group ID and if there's any query, you can share it. Good night. Otherwise, we'll be meeting in a PCP lecture where we can meet face to face. Goodbye, good night, all the best.